So, the importance of motor fitness. We look at components of motor fitness being speed, agility, balance, coordination, power and reaction. All these motor skills allow for us to move in different ways, play sports, get involved in the gym, and move generally around when we walk in. So, in terms of motor skills and motor fitness, kinesthetic spatial awareness is vitally important in increasing that. So we need to understand how our body moves, understand the range of movements that allow us to go to certain places. That comes down to stride length, foot positioning, the angles and insertions that our muscles and joints allow us to go down in terms of, if you think about a squat, the technique of a squat in making sure that our knees don't go internally rotating between our feet and our toes, because that's not natural in terms of our motor skills and the way our bodies kinesthetically move. There's a massive link between developing motor skills and the central and peripheral nervous system. So motor skills develop through understanding the brain connection and doing all these movements, because there's a message that goes down through our nervous system from our brain to our motor units and motor neurons within our muscles to do that. Now, if we can increase the amount of motor units at the muscular end, or increase the amount of motor neurons at the brain's end, we can then increase the amount, reduce the amount of time it takes for our brain to tell our muscles to contract and do that physical movement. What that will do is increase our reaction time, and our coordination will get a lot better in terms of the motor skills that it uses. Things to develop those mind-muscle connections and the neurons and motor units is to do exercise and activity every day. Because if we do that, our body's going to adapt. It's going to need to become quicker and faster to allow that motor skills and motor fitness to develop over time. This will also entail an increase in sporting performance and a reduction in risk to injury. So, developing motor skills and motor fitness, there are three main stages of motor skills within the learning process. Those are cognitive, in terms of you thinking about doing a movement and then doing it. Motor, in terms of thinking about it and the movement actually happening. And then automatic, which is an autonomous movement where you react and you do it without having to physically concentrate and think about it as much as you would do. These learning processes happen over time, and eventually through the motor skill development, the older you get and the more you do the skills, it becomes more natural and it becomes almost like second nature. Working with young people between 14 and 16, what you'll find is muscle growth doesn't keep up with bone growth. So what you'll find is they'll get taller and they'll get leaner, and the muscles won't be able to contract to the point of moving them in a quick way as much as you would do as a developed adult. So very high intensity training should be avoided when you work with this age group. Like we said, when we talked about muscular development and flexibility, they're not going to be able to sustain maximum load of 75% of their one rep max, as it's going to hinder their growth and prevent them from developing in a natural way. Weight bearing is an important feature of their development. So getting them to do exercise, whether it's body weight or low resistance, maybe 40 to 60% of their one rep max for repetitions, develops that muscle to almost keep up with that bone growth. When we think about people of a young age, we want to avoid prolonged high intensity anaerobic training. Their energy systems aren't developed enough to be able to sustain high intensity exercise. It's going to cause them a hindrance and cause a lot of risk to injury. With young people, what I would do and I would recommend is to include bodyweight exercises incorporating gravity and low length, lever length in terms of press-ups, squats, dips on a chair, and think about how you can move their body in a natural kinesthetic way in terms of the way they move their bodies naturally. On top of this, what I would do, keep them interested, stop them getting bored, is incorporate developing motor skills. So can they do squats with the ball, incorporating catching, reaction time, developing those finer motor skills along with doing physical development exercises. Okay, looking at the cognitive and the learning processes of developing motor skills, not just for young people, but for older people. What we're going to consider is the anti-postnatal clients, so pregnant, and then once they've given birth, become postnatal. We want to consider the hormone relaxing effects to joint stability, so the ability of their pelvis to become more relaxed increases the greater risk of injury. Timescales for release of that hormone relaxing should be considered. So in terms of prenatal, there's going to be more relaxing within the body, so we want to stop and prevent hip hinging movements as much as possible. Postnatal, the relaxing hormone is going to reduce a little bit, still going to be higher than genetically normal than when there was no baby involved at all. So we need to consider that. So just giving appropriate exercises. Now, appropriate exercises that I would include and recommend would be to do forms of interval type training, not to a high intensity, but bouts of stop, start, stop, start, to give them a rest, to give them that breather and allow for oxygen to be circulated around the body. Maintaining stretches, like static stretches, to give that relaxing and the synovial fluid within the joints to keep that flexibility within the working body and not allow our range of movement to decrease, whether it's antenatal or postnatal. What I would work to do with my clients that are postnatal is to work with core stability exercises, developing that core to come back to a normal function in terms of the posture, as posture can be hindered and reduce and get worse as we get pregnant due to the weight and the different and the adaptations that our body has had. Exercises that I would avoid would be supine position exercises after their first trimester, because what you're gonna see is the body's adaptation is gonna be initially quite high with the growth and the movement of the abdominal muscles. Supine exercises are not gonna be very well supporting of overloading your back muscles and your core. I would probably avoid doing anything such as ballistic stretching or PNF stretching around flexibility, as it's going to put a lot of strain on the range of movement within the joints. Like I said, relaxing is going to be released within the body, so putting them through a higher range of movement within PNF and ballistic stretching could cause a lot of injury and scar tissue within the connective tissue. And also high impact exercises. So we don't want to do any powerlifting or anything in terms of extreme weight bearing or anything that is running on a treadmill for so long. If you can do cardio exercise without a treadmill or without running on maybe like a bike or swimming, keep that cardiovascular fitness up. That's going to be very healthy for the baby and very healthy for the young lady. If we move on and we look at age-related effects in terms of developing that motor skills, aging communities have metabolic rate tends to decrease. So what they'll have is they'll have a loss of muscle tissue, a loss of bone density, and increased risk to injuries or falls. Now, with the aging population, exercises that I would look to include to help prevent and help slow down that aging process would be back extensions, internal interval type training where they can have a break, can have a bout of exercise that isn't to a high intensity or impact. Working on multi-joint compound lifts that allows them to go through ranges of movements to develop a lot more core strength and increase their posture over time. Exercises to avoid would be high impact, prone flexion activities where they're putting themselves through over maybe 60% of their one rep max and causing complicated postural issues. When we think about the disability community, what I want us to think about is not what you think's best for them, but what the GP and what an expert in the field of their disability would recommend. So before you take on a client with a disability, you need to make sure that they have got a note from their GP or have some sort of evidence to be able to come to you and say, this is what I've been suggested from an expert practitioner to say that I can do this and I can't do that. You don't want to take on someone with a disability and cause them more harm in terms of them having poorer motor unit skills or poorer range of movement and have their disability get worse. Always seek professional advice from a GP or from a physio that's going to give you some solid advice of what exercises to use to help develop that person with a disability, depending on what that disability is.